mi gente, ¿cómo estás? I'm reporting live from Santiago de Cuba, and hopefully you can hear me. So loud. People always say New York is so loud. I always have to point this out. This video is just Notas and Santiago de Cuba, so just notes on Santiago. I did a video in the past, so loud. I did a video last year on Santiago de Cuba when I came here for the first time in April, May of 2017. It is now September 2018. And I came back, and my main reason for wanting to come to Santiago is to study the dances. And for those of you who follow me, you know that I'm a serious student of the African diaspora. And so that means, especially in the Americas and the Congo. The Congolese dance is the only African dance style that I study. But I study dances from Haiti, Cuba, Puerto Rico, Dominican Republic, Brazil, Peru, Colombia, America, North America, where I'm from. And in the U.S., when people teach Afro-Cuban dance classes, it's usually Orisha dances. And Orisha is Yoruba in origin. And so that is the main thing you see in the U.S. when people say Afro-Cuban. But Afro-Cuban dance is a wide, wide circle umbrella of things. Dances from Dahomey, dances from the Congo, dances from Haiti. And so Santiago is right across the water from Haiti, and Jamaica's not too far either. Cuba is really huge. A lot of people don't realize how big Cuba is. You should look at a map and see how big Cuba is compared to the other islands in the Caribbean. It is also, just a little side note, one of the best, probably the best island to be on during a hurricane, because everything here is made solid. Like, these are all solid structures. Nothing here is blowing away. I mean, every year hurricane season, you never hear that Cuba got destroyed. So it's built very solid. But Havana is the largest city in Cuba, and that is in the northern tip. And Santiago is in the southeast. And it's like the distance of, like, from D.C. to Miami. That's how far away they are. And so Santiago has a different culture, and very strong Black culture, and a very strong Haitian Afro-Cuban influence as well. And so there are dances from Santiago that are Haitian Afro-Cuban. They came with Haitians after the Haitian Revolution. And I'm really not, you know what, I need to ask some more questions, and if anybody's watching this video and knows the answers to this or has any information, please feel free to write it. So I'm not completely sure when this Haitian influence in the dancing, like the dances that I studied, I'm not sure if this came from right after the Haitian Revolution, when Haitians first started coming, or if that influence of dances came up until the 20th century. I don't know. So I need to find that out. But what I will say is I have studied Haitian dance a lot with many different teachers. And I'm never done studying, but from what I have seen of the dances from Haiti and the Haitian Afro-Cuban dances, the Haitian Afro-Cuban dances are very different than the Haitian dances. So even though they have the same name, Igbo, Nago, Petwo, Nyanvalu, I haven't seen all of the Cuban versions. I haven't seen all of the Haitian Afro-Cuban versions, the Cuban-Haitian versions. I haven't seen them. I have not seen how they do Yambalu. So there's a few dances I haven't seen, but the dances that I have seen, like Igbo, like Gaga or Rara, is very different. How the Haitian Afro-Cuban version is very different than the Cuban. And actually, I wanted to get into this whole dance lecture in another video, so I don't want to get too much into this, but I'm already getting into it. Basically, just to tell you that there is a different culture in Santiago as compared to Havana. Just like in the United States, New Orleans has a different culture than New York City. New York City and New Orleans are both very important cities. They're both cities full of culture and traditions, and they're very unique, very different, very far from each other. Same thing with Havana and Santiago. When most people come to Cuba, they come to Havana because that's where most of the tourists go, and it's much easier to get to. So I did a video in the past, like I said, on Santiago. So check it out. I don't want to repeat a lot, so if I do repeat some things, I'm sorry. But I have a bunch of notes that I was taking. I still haven't done the video that I wanted to do from the last time I was in Cuba, in Havana, in June. But I said this probably in my other video, that Santiago is much cheaper than Havana. Havana's pretty cheap as well, but Santiago's even cheaper because there's not a lot of tourists in Santiago. So most of everything is priced in their money. And if you haven't seen in my other videos, or if you don't already know, there are two different currencies in Cuba. One for tourists and one for Cubans. And CUC is what they give tourists. And one CUC equals one US dollar. But in the Cuban money, 24 of their dollars equals one of ours. So if something says $2 and it's in their money, that is like penny, that's like not even 10 cents for us, okay? That'd be like 6 cents or something. And so it's a lot cheaper here. Also, you want to make sure that you get their currency to pay for things here. You want to make sure of that. And you want to make sure... Oh, God, I'm sorry. I've had a long day of dancing, so my brain... Not only have I had a long day of dancing, but another note about not just Santiago, but Cuba in general, is that people talk you to death. And people talk to you about serious subjects. People don't talk to you about nonsense. And even if you tell somebody that your Spanish is not that good, they will still keep talking to you. I feel like in America, if you start speaking to somebody and you realize, oh, this person doesn't speak English, usually you leave them alone. You know, like if they're sitting there eating something or whatever they're doing, usually leave them alone. Here they don't do that. Telling them that your Spanish isn't that good, or telling them that you don't speak Spanish at all, does not stop them from talking to you continuously. And it's about important and interesting subjects. I understand Spanish better than I can speak it. Definitely being in Cuba, speaking of Spanish is getting better, but I'm not fluent. But I can understand it better than I can speak it. I wouldn't recommend coming to Cuba or to Santiago, but to Cuba in general, really, if you don't speak some Spanish. Just some. I mean, there are a lot of people who come here, I guess, and don't speak any, but I don't know how they do that, because most people here don't speak any English at all. And even if you have a Google Translator, not everybody understands what you wrote, because sometimes the translations aren't correct, or they're so literal that it's not what you were trying to say. And if you don't speak enough Spanish to realize that, because there's times I write something in the Google Translator, and when I see the translation, I know it's wrong, because I know enough Spanish to be like, oh, no. But then what I have found to be a big issue is that when people write things to me, like if somebody who speaks Spanish wants to write something in Spanish in a Google Translator, when I read the English translation, it never makes any sense to me at all. Like, I don't even, like, kind of understand what they're saying. So I don't find that to be super helpful. So you have to still speak some Spanish. There are lots of people in Santiago running around in motorcycles. Like, motorcycles are just as popular as cars. But there are motorcycles everywhere, flying. So crossing the street, you have to really pay attention. And most motorcycles have two people on them. I would be way too scared to be riding all through a city, a busy city, with people all on the street. Because in Cuba, in general, people are in the street. People walk in the lanes of the street as if they are a car. So they themselves will be walking in the lane, like, with the cars. Like, you're not a car. Like, why are you? And with their back to traffic. I know I was taught, if you ever walk in the street, walk towards traffic. You walk to ongoing traffic so you can see it. They walk with traffic behind them. They don't turn around. They don't flinch. if somebody is ever stressed about New York City and it's like, oh my God, I can't drive in New York City, oh my God, then you couldn't survive here, because this is New York times 100, okay? Way another level, okay? There's no driving rules, people don't even have stop signs half the time, they're just flying, right? So you have to be careful when you cross the street. And it's amazing because you see so many kids, all the kids, going to school, they're not with adults, little kids. Last night, it was like 10:30 at night, I saw two little boys walking up this hill, and their parents aren't terrified they might get hit by something. There's no street signs here to say cross and don't walk, and these kids are moving around, going to school, and they're so well behaved. You don't see them arguing, I don't see them bullying each other, I don't see them fighting, none of them, you know? And then, also about Santiago, and it's cloudy right now. It's been so hot. It is so hot here. If you think it's hot in Miami, if you think it's hot in Havana, it is so much hotter here. So it's really hot, but it cools down every single day. So every single day it's really hot, and every single day it cools down. Usually it starts to pour really hard, like the world's coming to an end, like rainforest rain. Today it has not rained. I thought it was. I was trying to get back in before it did rain. It's not raining, but as you see, it's cloudy. Yesterday I wanted to record this video, and it was so much, at the same time, there was so much sun that I couldn't keep my eyes open up here. So I had to not do it yesterday, and then today it's super cloudy. But you know the tropical weather anyway, you know. But definitely in Cuba in particular, there's a pattern of hot sun and intense rain every day. Florida can be like that too. Rain and sun every day. Just the rain here is even more intense, and the heat is more intense. Spanish here, I understand the Spanish of people better in Santiago than I do in Havana. In Havana, I really don't understand what people are saying most of the time. Like, people will be speaking to me and I'm like, what? I just have no idea. A lot of the times, not always. But in Santiago, people, I understand them much better. Not sure what that is, but I do. Santiago is also very black, but Cuba is very black. I mean, I have only been to Havana and Santiago, the two biggest cities. Havana is the first biggest, Santiago is the second biggest. I want to go to Trinidad, which is another dope place, and Matanzas, where it's like the Matanzas is where rumba is really strong, and that's like an hour from Havana. There's other places I want to go to in Cuba, but where I've been to, very black, very, very black. Lots of black people, and like lots of indigenous people. And just like in America, the indigenous people really don't know who they are. I saw an indigenous man, he was straight up native. His skin was red, like as red can be. Brown, red, like his features, his hair, you could straight up native, indigenous. And he's telling me he's native to Cuba, like he's like, you know, basically like he's from here, like, you know. And so I asked him, where's your family from? Like, you know, and basically trying to ask him where they're from, what's their origin, and he was just like, he doesn't know. He said he didn't know, and then he put his arm next to mine, basically to say that we're both colored. Both brown, we're both kind of like that black unity, except he was not African, and that's why I use the term Afro-Indigenous, because myself and most black Americans I know, and a lot of black people in the Americas, have indigenous blood and native blood, and then there are some people who are straight up indigenous who identify as black, but then there's also, especially in Cuba, there are lots of black people in Cuba, sometimes you can't tell by looking at people, but there are lots of black people in Cuba who look like they're straight up African. And then there's people who look like they're straight up indigenous. And then there are people who look like they're a mixture of both, which is what you see all throughout America. But in Cuba, I've seen some of the darkest, blackest people that I've ever seen. I remember coming here last year with a friend of mine who was Nigerian, and he said he had not seen people that dark in Nigeria, like literally the color black. But then you have people who look, it is so hot here. If you're indigenous from this land, there's no way that you're light skinned. The indigenous people are dark too. It's just a totally different color, it's a different shade. Just like people from India are dark and can be very dark, but their undertones, their shade of skin does not look like an African. So we need to open our eyes to that. And this is something I talk about because I have a video on this YouTube page about Afro-Indigenous, about that whole topic, so I'm not going to get too much into that, but you definitely see Indigenous people here. Definitely Afro-Indigenous people here. The Heladeria, which is an ice cream shop, which Cuba has a big ice cream culture. I think I've talked about this in other videos, because there are videos I didn't do from June when I came back from Havana that I need to do. But in case I have not said this and you haven't heard it, Cuba has a huge ice cream culture. There are ice cream restaurants here with tables and waiters, and they come take your order and they bring you this beautiful platter of ice cream. And yeah, and so the one that I found here had 24 tables in it, and each table had 4 chairs, okay? It opens at 8:30 in the morning and closes at 10:30 at night. I had 8 scoops of ice cream before dance rehearsal. I should have gone and got 8 more, but because it's so light, it's like a very light ice cream. I got 8 scoops before, and it was 20 pesos, which is $20 in their dollars. So that's less than a dollar in our money, because 24 of their dollars is one of ours. So it's $20 in their money. So basically, it was less than a dollar for me to get 8 scoops of ice cream. And so I love that, this ice cream culture here. Also, like Havana, if anybody's been to Havana, you have an area like Old Havana, Havana Vieja. You have that, and then you have like Vedado, which is a nice neighborhood, which is where I've stayed in all 3 times I've been in Havana. I stayed in Vedado, and it's a beautiful neighborhood. Very different than Old Havana. It's like, I don't know, like staying in Old Havana to me is like staying in Times Square. It's just too busy, too many tourists. But I wouldn't want it. No nature, no trees. Vedado, there's beautiful trees and stuff like that. What was I gonna say? And Santiago's the same way. The neighborhood that I'm in now does not have a lot of trees. It reminds me of Old Havana, actually. But where I'm staying, there's actually a lot of nature and fruit growing. I'm just sitting on the top balcony, so you can't see it. If I sat downstairs, you would be able to see it. And this light is so not good. It's so boring and dreary. I'm sorry. I hope you guys listen to the video anyway. I had a long day of dancing really, really hard. I have so much to share. Some of the stuff I'll be sharing on Instagram, some of it on YouTube. I need to write about these things that I'm learning. And I'm going to do another video. This video, I've been talking for almost 20 minutes. I'm probably boring you guys. So I'm going to do another video with some better light. Add on any other notes I need to. If you haven't seen my other videos on Cuba, please check them out. And I know I have some other things to say, but I have a headache. But also, I'm going to do a video on what I have learned from studying with a dancer from Katumba Dance Company here in Santiago. So stay tuned for that video. And thank you for listening. If you learned something, share it.